Good morning. So, we're going to try and start closer to on time so we get the children down for Sunday school sooner. So they have a little bit more time, because the way we've been doing it with, I kind of wait until everybody's in, and then that gives Sunday school like 15 minutes downstairs. So we're going to try and start more on time and give them a little bit more time to interact and play downstairs. I have to start off with a confession. As many of you know, I was not here last Sunday, and the real reason is a difficult one to bring up for some of you. I am contractually obligated to not preach or talk about the Apple Cup following the game. So I just couldn't be here on that Sunday because, you know, we crushed you. So. Also, I was in the emergency room, but mostly the Apple Cup. Now I am heavily medicated, so you get the heavily medicated version of me today, so enjoy. I can only imagine what's about to unfold. And today is good because there's going to be some off-the-cuff segments, so we really don't know what's going to happen at that point. But big thanks to Pastor George, the sermonator, for taking over last Sunday and doing such an admirable job. Some announcements. This is First Lutheran the Great Sunday, what some might call Stewardship Sunday. So this is the Sunday for you to remember that you forgot your offering under your stewardship envelopes and then turn them in next time. So if you brought them, great, put them in the offering plate or offering box when that goes around at offering time. But otherwise, for every single other person here, bring them back as soon as you are able so we know where we stand. If you're not able to give this year, we're okay. This is not a guilt trip, but we just want to know where we stand. Some other announcements. Wednesday, December 16th at 7 p.m. is our Blue Christmas service. This can be a difficult time for people, Christmas time, remembering those that are not around the table or remembering a hard year. And so Blue Christmas is that time to gather together and remember that you have extra support to sing those songs that bring you some joy and to be honest about this Christmas season. So that's our December 16th at 7 p.m. There's a longest night service on Monday, December 21st at 5:30 p.m. at First Christian Church in Bremerton. That's when we're going to be taking all those blankets we collected and giving them to people in need over in Bremerton. So come and take part in that. It's going to be the four churches out here that we partner with are going to go over there and bring our blankets there. So come and take part of that service. It'll be a short service to remember all the homeless that have passed away on the streets.
And it's outside also.
It's outside, so dress warm. Dress very warm. This is the last... Jordan's going to make that announcement. Sunday school is still available downstairs, so we have some people... We were making that transition in Lent, and I don't know how many of you read Facebook, but one thing we found talking to a lot of our families is that for some, this was the idea of stopping Sunday school even for 6 weeks was, people were conflicted about that. And we want to be, we want to work with you. We don't want to make these new ideas to be a scary thing. So in Advent, we are going to continue to have Sunday school downstairs for those that want their kids to have that experience. Their kids need that experience. And so you can kind of vote for what you want for the future by sending your kids to either downstairs for Sunday school or leaving them in church in Lent. We're going to have more activities on that. Mackenzie is in the back. She is our Sunday school helper. She is normally in the cry room. We decided to bring her into here. So if you need help, if there is a crying kid that you want to pawn off, maybe we'll hand off our kids. She could take them back into the crying room if they wanted, or they can stay here. She's also going to be working to teach sign language to the kids and a lot of other things throughout the service. And also, this is the first Sunday for Jacob Hasselbrock as our youth leader in training. So we welcome him on. You are so excited about church. I'm right there with you, buddy. Let's see here. Next Sunday is our appreciation celebration. when we celebrate our volunteers, which is all of you. It'll be from 10 to 10:30, and there'll be goodies and lots of love to share. So let's see. Yoga, if you remember, yoga is Thursdays at noon. That's been going really well here. So well that we're going to start in the new year having a Wednesday at 6:45 at night time. So if anybody wants to come and do yoga at night, Wednesday, 6:45, starting that first Wednesday of the new year. I think people here have been getting a lot out of it, and Nina, the teacher of that, loves you all. And so she wants more of you to get involved. So we'll have two times starting the new year, Thursday at noon, and Wednesday at 6:45. We're going to start so soon, buddy, I promise you. Let's see, Jordan, I believe, is going to make an announcement.
Hi. So my mom wanted me to come up here and talk because she's actually with the 5th and 6th graders getting angel tree gifts. And this is the last week to pick up tags. The angel tree, they're due back next week. So please take tags. We would like them to help. Thanks.
Go Hawks. Are you just randomly sitting up here, or are you just kind of screwing with me? And we have any? Do you want to plug something about Frogs and Toads?
Two more weekends. Frog and Toad. Let's show up at 5 o'clock today.
Two more weekends of Frog and Toad. Any other announcements? All right, as you witnessed last Sunday, but I did not, Kelly shared, children's time is going to be in a little bit, but you can totally come up. That's a really nice hat, by the way. Kelly shared something. Advent is about waiting, but it's also about expectantly looking forward. And we're looking forward to Christmas morning, to that time when God became one of us, when God became part of our family, the family of humanity. And so we've invited people to share their story of why they look forward to Christmas, and then have them light two blue candles, Nadia, to light two of them for this Sunday. So we're going to invite up Nadia to talk to us a little bit about why she looks forward to Christmas.
I have one quick announcement too, but I'm sorry. So I want to thank Rebecca Sorter, because she has put together this next week three different meetings with three different churches for me to go and talk to about joining our community aid fund. She is relentless, and it was awesome to watch her do it. Thank you. Well, today's my turn to talk about why Christmas is important to me, but also because the main reason is I was asked is to remember something that stands out from Christmas past. And I have many Christmas pasts that are stand out. I have a huge family, so there was all kinds of wonderful times at Christmas with the family. But what stands out the most to me is my youngest brother and I, who's 2 years younger than I am, he is an amazing person today, and he was an amazing person back then. And my sisters, they would get the Christmas tree and they'd put it up every Christmas, and they would untangle the Christmas lights and they would take out all the ornaments and sit around and chat and had drink coffee and play cards as my brother and I put together the tree. And they would watch us do this for hours. And I thought, these are really patient people, because now I think about it and I'm thinking, how did they do that? How did they have this patience for us? Anyway, so we put the tree together and we thought we had put together the most amazing tree every single year. And time to go to bed. Great, yeah. So they would send us off to bed, and they would praise how wonderful that tree looked. And off the bed we went. The next morning, we would get up and go, wow, this is amazing. We are really, really good at this, you know? And the tree was perfect, just like we remembered it, you know? Just perfect when we went to bed. It was even more perfect. And not till I got older did we realize really what was happening, because we would start becoming part of those kids, part of the adults. And their kids and my nephews and nieces were the ones that were doing the tree now. And they would, the patience they had just reminds me of just what wonderful angels my sisters are. And they really are. And to have that memory is just, and to be able to do that as a kid and not have anybody go, oh, don't put it there, don't put it there. They just let us throw stuff on there. And we thought it was amazing. And they still did it for their kids as they got older. So that is very, very embedded in my mind and so in my heart. Thank you.
Please stand as you're able to sing.
Please be seated. There was a meeting recently of pastors in the area. The superintendent called us all together. And I wasn't able to be there. It was a breakfast meeting on a day when I had three breakfast meetings. And they got to this conversation about helping the community. The superintendent wanted pastors to start working together to better this community, maybe take on one big project to help those in need in our community. And there were three, or I wasn't there, but the people reported back to me, because I have spies everywhere. People reported back to me, and three or four pastors raised their hand and said, oh, we don't need to do that. First Lutheran's already doing it. Wow. Really happened. Which is sad, but you don't realize how well this church is known. You don't realize the impact, all the things that you are doing. The number of times people come to me and say, we as a church don't do a whole lot. No. We do a crazy amount. We do an over-the-top amount. This church is so special in all the things that it does, all the things that it's willing to try. All the ways that we work to engage our community, to let people in our community know that they are not alone. So many of you have given so much of your time, so much of your energy, so much of your money, and so much of your passion to transform this community into a place where people know where to go now. People know where to go when they need help. People walk into our doors all the time and they say, we've heard this is the church that cares about people. We've heard this is the church that's trying to make a difference. We heard that you are people that are actually working to be Christians. Not just say it, but be Christians in the world. I can't tell you how many of you don't realize how great this church is. How great all that you do is. How great all that you've done is. It's why we take out this Sunday to talk about First Lutheran the Great. To remind you of all that we can be, all that we are, and all that we're already doing. A lot of times, I just step back and marvel at everything that you take on. I read an article recently. Actually, it came up on my news feed, and I just read the subject of it, so I know what the article said. But it said how pastoral care is killing the church. Because at a lot of churches, people just think, all pastoral visits, all spiritual visits, all visiting the sick visits are just for the pastor. But not here. It's so hard for me to find out when one of you are in the hospital and to get there before 20 people have already been there. You visit each other. You share with each other. You connect with each other. You are community. And to think about the fact that you guys are community, when I know what a lot of you think politically, when I know what a lot of you think theologically, when I know what a lot of you think about every different topic and none of you agree, and yet you still sit sometimes on the same side. You know, this isn't the Democrat, independent, Republican area. No, you guys are together as one church. You give so much, and you never realize how great you truly are. It's a blessing to come here and work. It's a blessing to be part of this staff, to be part of this mission, to be part of this body that is the church. Some days I get migraines, some days I get tired, some days I get exhausted. But every day I'm happy to be here because of all of you, because of all that you are doing for this church and this community, willing to try things. And when we try things, you actually tell me what you think. I mean, whether I want to hear it or not, that's true. But I do want to hear it. That honesty is great. We're trying to build something here. Being a church today is hard. Knowing what to do as a church for so many different generations, so many different ways of thinking and learning, it can be exhausting, but we are working on it together. And knowing that we're in this together makes all the difference. So on this First Lutheran the Great Sunday, let me say thank you. Thank you for being all that you are. Thank you for doing all that you do. And thank you for being the people that make up this great church. Amen. Take a moment now and greet your great neighbor. So what are your senses? You see, yeah. Hear, here's another one. Yeah. Smell is another one. So you got see, you got hear, you got smell, you got taste, and you got touch. That's right. So we're going to see, we're going to test your senses, okay? So I'm going to bring this around. We're going to do smell first. So when you smell, you have to close your eyes, of course, because if you see this, that's cheating. Okay, so see if you can smell. So I'll bring it around. So let's go ahead and smell, see if you can smell, and don't shout out what it is. You smell it? Yeah? So don't shout out your answer, think about it. Smell it? Smell? 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 You're trying to smell it. Smell. No? Okay. Smell. All right. Did anybody know what that was? Yeah.
Peppermint.
Peppermint. That's right. And what kind of peppermint do you get this time of year? Candy cane. That's right. It was a candy cane. So you guys are very good at this. All right. The next one is hearing. So tell me if you can tell me what this is. Jingle bells, that's right. All right, okay, this next one is, I want you to reach in here. It's a little sharp. It's my collection of razor blades, just kidding. And tell me what, if there's kind of a shape, but it's also something if you can guess. So try and reach in there without looking and just guess what it, no? Can I try and feel it? Don't look, you can't look, you just have to reach in and feel it. You know what it is? Reach in and feel. You know what it is? Okay. You want to reach in and feel? Shh. All right. You want to reach in and feel? Okay. All right. Do you want to try and reach in and feel? Oh, well, you can take it out. That's fine. So what was it? Yeah. Huh? Not Ollie, no. What is it? A star, that's right. It's kind of an ornament there. Sometimes you put them on the top of a tree. All right, and now we're going to see something. So everyone turn and look at Mackenzie. And she's going to show you guys something. Okay, do you know what she just did? She did use sign language, but do you know what she spelled out for you guys? All right, she's gonna teach us it. She's gonna say each letter. So see if you can put all the letters together. It's hard. C, can you all do C? Everyone at home can do it. C. H. R. Wait till the end. I. Do the signs. S. S.
T.
M.
A.
S. S. And then the big one. What does it spell? Christmas. Yeah, and then this is the sign for Christmas. So can everybody do the sign for Christmas? So you got that by just seeing. I mean, eventually we talked about it. So here, turn back around. So when we pray, it's usually in our heads, right? We say something kind of quiet in our heads. Sometimes we'll say it out loud, but a lot of times we say it quiet in our heads. Well, our faith, what we believe, is supposed to be a part of all of our being. We're supposed to see God, to feel God, to taste God, to hear God, to smell God. Sorry. What do you think God smells like? Peppermint, yes. That's a good answer. I didn't have an answer to that one. So that's God, we're supposed to see all these things and look for God and taste for God and feel for God. We didn't do taste, but you are going to get to take home a candy cane. Just remember, I'm going to give you a candy cane. Your parents might take away that candy cane. But remember that Pastor Adrian gave you candy cane. Well, this will be your third one then. So I'm going to give you that after we pray. But it's important for you to remember that we're not just supposed to have our faith in here or in here, but we're meant to live our faith. And Christmas is the best time of year to do that. because we get to smell Christmas with the peppermint. We get to hear Christmas with the jingle bells. We get to taste Christmas with the candy cane. We get to do all of that and have a whole lot of fun. So Christmas is a time of year to remind us that God is everywhere. So let us pray. Let us pray, let us pray, let us pray.
Dear God,
thank you for jingle bells, for peppermint, for stars,
for sign language.
Thank you
for all those things
that remind us
you are real
and in our lives.
And all God's children said,
Amen. All right, come and get your candy cane and then run it by your parents.
Jesus. It is right for me to feel this way about all of you, since I have you in my heart. For whether I am in chains or defending and confirming the gospel, all of you share in God's grace with me. God can testify how I long for all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus. And this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless until the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. And here ends our first reading.
Our gospel for this day is on Luke chapter 3, verses 1 through 6, and this is on page 45 in your New Testament if you'd like to follow along. Hear the good news on this day. In the 15th year of the reign of Emperor Tiberius, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, and Herod was ruler of Galilee, and his brother Philip, ruler of the region of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Lysanias, ruler of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, and ordered it. And now you're all glad you didn't have to read this. He went into all the region around the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sin, as it is written in the book of the words of the prophet Isaiah, the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be made low. The crooked shall be made straight, and the rough ways made smooth. And all flesh shall see the salvation of God. This is our good news on this day. Grace and peace to you from God, our Creator and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. It's that time of year when we get this John the Baptist reading. You get it every single year. You don't get any days off for good behavior. Every single year we read this John the Baptist reading. Most of you could throw out parts of it from memory, or at least you'd recognize it as being, they're talking about John the Baptist. But you hear it, and we say it so fast, because it rolls off the tongue. Prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight, every valley shall be, every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked made straight, and rough made smooth, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God. We read through it so fast, knowing it so well, that it's taken this long for me to realize what I've been missing all along. An important phrase. All flesh shall see the salvation of God. Not all flesh shall hear, or all flesh shall know, or all flesh shall have faith in the salvation of God, but see the salvation of God. Think about this word. Think about what comes to mind when you hear the word salvation, about being saved from something. Does any part of what comes to mind involve what you see? Salvation, we generally say, is about death or life after death. We certainly don't see that unless you watch Ghost Adventures every Saturday night like I do. Or we might say salvation is about faith, having the right faith. But can you see faith? Or it's about confessing the right thing, but can you see a confession? I mean, that's a matter of the heart, not a matter of something you see. How do we see salvation? It seems to imply that there's something to salvation that involves the senses. Our hint to an answer comes a little earlier when the gospel tells us what John was doing. It says, he went into all the region around the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. When we talk about forgiveness, we, I think, rightly latch on to the parts where we confess something, we offer something we did wrong to God, and God forgives it. But there's another piece to that. And the Greek word for forgiveness, for repentance, rather, talks about living it, living lives of repentance, living out fruits of repentance. The Greek word is metanoia, which I know you're all hastily writing down. It means a change of mind and heart, the kind of interchange that people can see. Ever heard someone say, and if they said this to you, you were probably in a lot of trouble, don't tell me you're sorry, show me you're sorry. You all just went back to that moment of terror. That's kind of metanoia. It's in part what we have salvation is meant to be seen and felt and smelt along with having some real information in our hearts. We are not meant to get salvation and then check that off our to-do list. We've done that, let's move on. We are meant to sense salvation to our very core so that our whole world is transformed. I want to share a story that I heard from a Catholic priest, Father Neil. And you're probably going to hear in this story the words or the phrase, Blessed Mother, more than you're comfortable with. But this is from a Catholic priest, so this is his experience. He tells a story that paints a picture of seeing salvation in this world, or at least sensing it. Father Neil traveled to, say this five times fast, Medjugorje. Medjugorje, Medjugorje, Medjugorje. I practiced that earlier. It's in Bosnia. He was meant to be the spiritual director of a pilgrimage that went to this holy place. There's a lot of miracle stories that happen on this hill, cross mountain rather. He'd heard all the stories about what the Blessed Mother did for people. Stories about rosaries transforming into gold or the sun starting to spin, but Father Neil didn't expect to experience any of that. Even being a Catholic priest, he was a little bit more cynical about the miracles of God actually existing in the world. But on the day they were to climb Cross Mountain, one of the pilgrims came over to Father Neil and told him that on this journey, he was going to smell roses. Now, in that area, it's thought that when you smell roses, you're in the presence of the divine. What does God smell like? Others say peppermint. In that area, they say roses. God smells like roses. And he laughed. He immediately laughed when she said that because it's October in Bosnia, so there's no flowers. And also his nose was clogged. He said to her, "I hope the Blessed Mother is an excellent ear, nose, and throat doctor because my nose is clogged and I'm not smelling anything." But she said that he was going to smell it. They began to climb slowly up because there are about 40 of them going up this Cross Mountain. Ever so often that pilgrim would look over at Father Neil and say, and he'd say, "No, I don't smell anything." But then suddenly he stopped. This whiff of sweet fragrance came past him. It was like somebody with a strong perfume had just run right past him, and it smelled like roses. And he looked over at the pilgrim and went, and she went. It happened two other times as they continued to climb. Finally, they arrive at the top. It's grass, but no flowers. And they start their final ascent up this kind of rough-hewn stairway up to where the cross is. And at the moment they got up there, he heard a voice, Father Neil heard a voice that said, "Neil, come over here." But none of the women of the group had spoken. He walked over and stood in front of the cross. He threw up his arms and said, "What do you want? Did you call me?" All of a sudden, he said, he was standing in a vacuum of roses. He couldn't smell anything else. It was overpowering, intoxicating roses. He didn't know if he should be jumping up and down and praising God or lying face down before the cross. He called out excitedly to that pilgrim to tell her what he was experiencing. She was 12 feet away from him and began to smile and laugh and said, "Do you smell the roses? The Blessed Mother is here." Father Neil didn't necessarily see salvation, but he sure smelled it. Our passage today, our gospel passage from John, causes us quickly to rush to all the things that Jesus is going to accomplish. He's going to do all these things. So we immediately jump to Good Friday and Easter, skipping not just Christmas, but his whole life going to the end. But it's actually a call for us to remember that there's a difference between doing something or accomplishing something and actually experiencing something. You might be saved, but can you see it? Can you live salvation? Can you live being saved? This Advent season, this season of slowing down and expecting, this season of slowing down and waiting is about trying to experience the salvation that has come and is coming and experience it to the very heart of our being. I don't know about you, but this time of year, my to-do list is terrible. I just keep adding to it, but I don't ever look at it anymore. It's just too depressing. And I always tell myself that after this season calms down, I'll get to it. I'll get to those things that I want to do rather than just getting to the things that I need to do. But does it ever calm down? Please say yes. Just fly me right now. I'm sick. Take pity on me. Everything about our lives becomes boxes we need to check off. Salvation to be done. Faith to be accomplished. One less thing to worry about. But we are meant to see salvation every day. To touch salvation. To taste salvation. To smell salvation. every day of our lives until it becomes part of our being, where nothing in this world can touch us because we have been saved from it, all of it. And we no longer need to tell people about salvation or to show people our salvation, but people can see it by our fruits. They can see it by the look on our faces. They can see it by those times we stop to smell the roses. Let some of those boxes this season go unchecked. Let some of them fall by the wayside and see what happens. In this Advent season, work to see, to taste, to smell salvation for yourself. For it has come for each and every one of us. And it's come to change our lives. Amen.
Amen.
We've seen too much wrong. We don't know how to fix it. We don't see the way forward. But you, God, are the God of the impossible. You are the God that can lead us to peace. You are the God that can lead us to brotherhood and sisterhood. You are the God that can fix broken minds and broken hearts. and open them to the possibility of your love. Be with those that are grieving this time of year. Be with those that feel alone this time of year. Be with those that are filled with hate this time of year, and bring them light. Bring them peace. Bring them hope. Lord, your mercy. Loving God, we pray for this church. We pray for First Lutheran the Great. That you would help us to understand that you are our greatness. You are the one that gives us mission. You are the one that brings us together. You are the one that sends us out. Help us to be a church that meets those needs, that cares, that loves. A church that draws together. A church that is family. A church that lifts all up to you and praises your holy name. Lord, your mercy. Loving God, we pray for those that are hurting in body, mind, and soul. We pray that you would heal them, that you would make them whole. We offer you their names now, either silently or aloud. Lift them up into your loving arms, O God, and let them know that they are never alone. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please stand as you are able. Remembering Jesus' life, his death, and his promise to come again, let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive the blessing of God. May you go forth from this place smelling for God, looking for God, listening for God, realizing that God is everywhere, and God goes with you no matter what you do, for God loves you. For this you are engaged, empowered, and rooted.